We've titled this session with Dibakar Banerjee rather intriguingly, Love, Hate, Politics, Art in the Age of Rage. As a good Bengali, Dibakar, you just saw at the moment, you're not a good Bengali. No. You want to take the mic and say that loudly to a Bengali audience that Dibakar Banerjee is not a good Bengali?
No, I'm not a good Bengali. I'm a Probashi Bengali. So there are many, many, foreign influences in my Bengaliness. So
what do you think is actually, what makes a good Bengali? What's the distinction you see between a Probashi and a real authentic Bengali?
Language. Language, because I think a Bengali who has lived in Bengal all his life will have a kind of language, Bangla, which a Probashi Bengali will never have. And a Probashi Bengali generally holds on to a kind of a Bangla which is 30 or 40 years in the past. But the Bangla of Bengal, the Bangla of Calcutta, the Bangla of the Mufassils and all that is a current live evolving Bangla, about which I don't have much knowledge.
But is there a cultural sensibility that unites the Bengali diaspora, if I can call it a diaspora, a sense of, authentic art, culture, a certain aesthetic? Is there a Bengali aesthetic that you are part of make your cinema?
See, the thing is, I grew up in Karol Bagh in Delhi. So my aesthetic was as much Punjabi and Haryanvi and Bengali. Which is why my first film is not Boshbadi. You know, my first film is Khosla Ka Ghosla. And I can speak perhaps Punjabi a little more fluently. No, maybe as fluently as Bengali. So the thing is, I remember as a Probashi Bengali, perhaps one of the reasons why it stuck, why we sort of a kind of congregated around Durga Puja and congregated around other things was that we needed to maintain some kind of an identity in Delhi, which was our own, which is a typical migrant mentality about holding on to something which is like a time capsule. Mm-hmm. And there's always a phase lag in terms of what you are with culturally and in the migrant cities and what you are with culturally at the center of that culture. And there's always a time lag, phase lag. So that's why I'm not perhaps, I won't say good or bad, perhaps I'm not a correct Bengali, because I'm always a little away from the current mainstream cultural zeitgeist that's happening in Bengal and in Calcutta. I wouldn't know about that.
So essentially, you're more comfortable with the world of the Khoslas than the world of the Chatterjees. Right? The world of the Khoslas is what you were more comfortable with when depicting on cinema than the world of Chatterjees. What's the difference between a good Punjabi in Karol Bagh and you think like your film Detective Byomkesh about a sort of Bengal or a Kolkata of the past?
Yeah.
What's the difference?
Anxiety. I think being a Bengali and living in my own family in Bengal as a migrant or something like that, I think Bengalis have a certain kind of a copyright on anxiety. And you don't see that much in a Punjabi household or with the friends that I grew up in my school or in my neighborhood. Or ki farak panda hai, ho jayega, chal na, aage chal. So that would happen, but...
would a Bengali say the same thing?
I don't think he will ever say ki farak panda hai. I'm a Bengali and I'm anxious, by the way. I'm an extremely anxious person and I'm anxiety ridden. So, I think that is the main thing. I mean, you worry about things.
I thought that was the pre-Saurav Ganguly Bengal. then suddenly the Bengali came to life, took his shirt off in the balcony of Lords. Yeah. I thought there was a new Bengali machismo emerging.
Well, there's an example of me not being a good Bengali because I'm not up to date with what's the cool latest Bengali thing in Bangla, because I would know about Bombay or Delhi. Not about Bengal.
Okay, so we've titled this session Love, Hate, Politics, Art in the Age of Rage. You saw the rage on the screen on the stage just now. Trinamool versus CPM versus BJP.
It's not rage yet. I would call it enthusiasm. We'll see when the rage comes in. I mean, we'll see when it turns into rage.
Are you comfortable with watching these politicians play act on stage?
I'm used to it. We've been seeing it forever. And some of them may not be play acting. And since I've been on stages and panels, what happens is that when you're called to a stage, you're not only representing yourself, you're representing something that's behind you. It could be your party, it could be your ideology, it could be your profession, it could be your agenda. So you're anxious. You're anxious to clarify that agenda and clarify that ideology so that you're a good representative. And that's the stage. The stage makes you do that. Because you're not only speaking for yourself, you're speaking for some other things that lead to you being here.
Let me put it this way. Let's talk about politics, for example. You in 2015 actually gave up your national award for Khosla Ka Ghosla because of what was happening in FTII. You made a political statement in a sense by doing what you did. Would you do it today? For example, if there was a lynching, I've seen other literateurs and award winners giving back their award, this so-called award Vapsi campaign, when a man was lynched allegedly for storing beef in his house. Would you, on a starkly political issue like that, take a stand? Or is it more comfortable for you to be in an area where you're taking stands on an issue like FTII?
I'll take a stand, but comfort doesn't have much to do with it. I think my stands are reserved. You see, stands work a bit like, now you're a conscientious person, and let's say you're saving up to give your money for a charitable cause. And ultimately, you'll have to choose between two charitable causes. Mm-hmm. And you will go with the cause that you have made up your mind about, that this is something that I will give whatever I can to, and that'll always be at the cost of something else. That does not make you a lesser person or you a less committed person. It's a stand. I have taken stands through my films, and the award Vapsi episode that happened in 2015 happened because I was seeing one of many educational institutions being eviscerated, and an institution is systems, an institution is the hotlines of teaching, an institution is questioning, an institution is debate. The first thing that you do in a classroom is ask a question. Without asking a question, no classroom can go ahead with a period. And what I realized was that asking questions about how FTII's governing body and its chairman were appointed were being deemed as illegal activities, and students were being put in jail about asking those questions. Hence, I decided, along with some other people, to give my award back so that I could draw the attention of parents and students and teachers and citizens across India to this problem. It was an attention-seeking device to draw the attention of parents and teachers who are not only film students, but who are students of other educational institutes. That's why I did what I did then. The lynchings, the dread, this feeling of something's wrong at the back of our heads, I knew it would happen. I predicted it. During our many interviews, during the award Vapsi, I said that if we don't speak now, this is where we will be today. So I will again, since you're asking that, what will you save your next award for? I've got only two. So abhi ek hi bacha hai. So I will save it for probably another such seminal incident, which probably is a focus and which probably can stand for many other such things to come in future if we don't check that thing there. Today, the lynchings, the killings, the sense of, as you said, self-censorship, it's all there because when there was time and when we could say, we didn't even squeak, and now we can't even squeak, and therefore I'm the one who's saying, I told you so. So I will choose my next award to be given up for somewhere when we come to that incident which will again to me will become a symbol of, if you don't stop now, it's going to get far worse.
I'm getting the sense though, in the last couple of years, you've become a little silent. Has the anger gone out of you? Has the rage gone out of you? 2015, you were angry. Your cinema was reflecting that. Films like Shanghai, films like Love, Sex or Dhoka, you were trying to stretch the boundaries. Now you're doing Netflix films on love. You know, you've moved into areas. Are you more comfortable talking about now? Have you softened up? Is there a self-censorship?
I love that contempt in your voice when you say Netflix films about love. And we will discuss this.
It was like a love story.
No, sure. No, I'm just saying that it's interesting because it's related. There's a saying in Bengali, and I mean it. Dudh kola diye pushchi. What it means is that I'm feeding my anger milk and bananas. And I'm getting it readier and readier. Now, what's happened in my real life is that I finished Byomkesh, and then I got busy with Love Stories. And after that, I had a film which was always on the cards, and I made it. For me, it takes time, two and a half years to finish every film and go to the next one. But the anger has not gone away, nowhere. But it's changed. It's modified into something, but that's my personal answer to it. I realized that whatever's happening is not an isolated political incident. To me, I think whatever's happening is related to many, many other things, one of which is the scared and angry male, which is why I made what I made for Lust Stories. It is about two scared males and one woman trying to break out of the fear.
And normalizing adultery, in a sense, right? The woman is in love with the man's best friend.
Yeah, and actually, it's very interesting. I didn't even see it as adultery till you said it. And very interestingly, I hadn't seen it like that. I had seen it like the daily occurrence of all of us being in love and lust with something that is socially not, certified, that's socially not agreed upon. And all of us in this room have been or may have been subject to those emotions and those things. And we do it. And it's a part of a negotiation that we do with who we are and who we want to be. And it's got essentially something to do with the angry male. Because I feel that whatever's happening today, and you were talking about the Gauri Lankesh murder, I think the Gauri Lankesh murder is connected to the angry male.
No, I spoke to him earlier about the Gauri Lankesh murder, asking why aren't you all making films, let's say, on immediate, relevant, newsy subjects that will shake the system. And there I referred to Gauri Lankesh's murder.
Sure. And
why don't you do a film like Hollywood has done with Post?
I don't know what Hollywood has done with Post. I only know what I'll do or some other filmmakers doing. As I'm speaking to you, I know there's another filmmaker who's making a film on a lynching. I know that I have decided and I'm making a film which has been provoked by the Gauri Lankesh murder. But here's the question. The question is that Gauri Lankesh pe main film to bana lunga, lekin I have to find a producer for that, no? Unfortunately, a film cannot be written like a book between just me and my laptop. I need to find the producer. I need to find the financer. I need to find the marketing infrastructure. Nobody helps me in doing that. So I have to take my anger. I have to take my script. I have to take my budget. I have to take my children's education fund. And I have to put them into one pot and then somehow get a film at the end of it. What happens is that while you do that, it takes time. That's one aspect. The second aspect is that while you do that, no one helps you. We're all talking about helping, we're all talking about being angry and, raising our voice and all that. Now, the thing is, when the few of us gave our awards back and actually started to draw people's attention towards what was happening in FTII, nobody really helped us. No one really came back and said, it's a good thing.
You're talking nobody meaning society or the film industry?
Society. Film says it wasn't a film event.
No, because I get a sense that Southern cinema, for example, the Prakash Rajas, he's out there, right? He's out there making political statements. I don't see Hindi film cinema taking stands on contentious issues. Does Hindi film cinema, or is it a reflection of society wants to play safe?
I have a feeling it's the latter, because I have a feeling that, I mean, what I saw was when we did that, the usual suspects sort of, you know, kind of came out and said, good, good, good. But my own friends and my own friends' parents, and they called up and said, hey, what are you doing? Are you behaving like a leftist? Or we were called Naxalites. While I don't remember a single agrarian land reform demand in what we said about FTII. So I have no idea why we were called Naxalites or anti-nationals. I have no idea why my friends called me up and said, tu aise kyun karta hai, kar raha hai yaar, ye to sab bekar hai. Focus on your films. So then what do I do? I'm talking not of me as a filmmaker. What does a filmmaker do? Does he focus on his films irrespective of what he's trying to what he's trying to reflect upon? Mm-hmm. Does he play safe? Because I have a feeling that an average filmmaker, the softest of the targets, feels probably the loneliest. And I'm talking about a filmmaker who's not only trying to make a film about the summer blockbuster hit or whatever. So we've left the filmmakers alone. Once we've left the filmmakers alone, once they know that nobody's going to come out and help them and speak for them, many of them will have to tone down their voices. Many of them will have to resort to nuanced expressions. Many of them will have to get into what you're saying, self-censorship, because they are using someone else's money, which is being funded by a corporate house, which corporate house will have its own political linkages and therefore levers and pressures. And then you're connected to the chain and you're not a sole person who's writing a poem or a book or a story. Even that doesn't happen. So it's much, much harder for a lone film director or a filmmaker to make a point that you would like him to make if there is not a modicum of some kind of a system which is immune to the pressures of the political and corporate nexus, which is immediately related to the fact that films need rather large sums of money to be made, even the smallest of them.
You're sounding rather disillusioned. Are you disillusioned with this crowd here? Are you disillusioned with the modern day Bengali, for example? When you made your film, Detective Byomkesh,
yeah,
the film didn't do as well as perhaps some of your earlier films, yeah, did. Were you searching for a Kolkata that didn't exist? Audiences have moved away. This is a new generation. Are you out of touch? Are you feeling disillusioned that there is all this anger within you, but society is moving, you know, they're not angry enough?
I hear you. There are two issues here. Byomkesh didn't do well has nothing to do with my voice being proscribed or there some kind of self-censorship or whatever. It is Byomkesh didn't do well because it didn't do well because people didn't connect to it. So that's a function of a filmmaker's usual cycle of life. Some things work, some things don't. So that's fine. And that doing well or not doing well is also a definition, which is, you know, we can debate about. But the disillusionment that you're talking about, yes, I'm a little disillusioned because, and I'm not disillusioned by any particular group of people, I'm disillusioned by the general Indian middle class, which is my primary audience, because I have a feeling that the primary concerns of celebrity worship and power worship have become so overriding for the Indian middle class that instead of being perhaps the most influential lever to push the national discourse in a certain way, it is sitting silently while the discourse moves on, absolutely irrespective of it.
Because in Khosla for, Ka Khosla, for example, you looked at the middle class and the manner in which a crucial issue for lots of middle class people getting a house and the corruption that is involved in that. Do you believe that the middle class needs to be shaken up much more than it is at the moment?
I believe, I mean, I've always tried to shake up the middle class because that's where I come from. I don't really understand any other class than the middle class because I belong to it. But I'm trying to figure out how to shake it up more, you know, because I'm, you know, that's the main problem because I don't know which push to give. And unfortunately, I am also a filmmaker. So I have to maintain that balance and make the film that I want to make, rather than it being a completely polemical exercise, because then it won't work as a film, which works on your hearts and on your minds. So the main dilemma is that, do people really care? 60% of my mind says no. They don't really care whether our educational institutes are destroyed. They don't really care whether the fundamental bloodlines, whether the fundamental institutions that perpetuate a participatory democracy in a country which is by definition diverse. I don't think 60% of our middle class are caring enough about the fact that if India is not diverse, India will destroy itself. India, it's a very simple metaphor. We are settling down for mono sound when we could have had 7.5 surround sound. I don't understand why a majority of the Indian middle class is acquiescing to a mono experience or sitting quietly by as the mono experience becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. It has got nothing to do with my films.
This is your man ki baat.
And it's got nothing to do with my films. It doesn't even mean that I'm a good filmmaker. What I'm trying to say is that many questions were asked during the award wopsy thing, that what do you think, why the film industry is not standing up? And my question was that this is not a film issue. This is an education issue. Democracy without education is meaningless. We are talking about educating. Therefore, I thought that it would be a parent issue. I thought it would be a student issue. I thought it would be a family issue. It remained a film issue. Haan ji, Dibakar ji, aapko kya lag raha hai? Film industry aapke saath nahi hai. And I kept on saying that this is, I'm not here as a film person. If this had been about the closure or the destruction of an engineering institute, and had I been an engineer, and if I had some kind of a public voice, I would have come up and I would have said it.
You should have lived in the Kolkata of the 60s, the angry, rebellious Kolkata. You grew up in the Delhi of the 90s, once Delhi was commercializing itself, moving in another direction.
I loved every bit of it. The reason why I'm here is because of 91, 92. We were talking about it. The reason why I'm here is because of Narasimha Rao, Manmohan Singh, the Indian experience of
You're a child of liberalization.
Absolutely.
Who's seen the malls come up in Karol Bagh.
Absolutely.
Who's seen Kolkata changing.
Absolutely. If I had been a young filmmaker, growing up in 60s, probably it would have been doubly difficult for me to make the kind of films that I made. And those films that I made, the new audience that came up because it was a brief period, which is still going on, about some kind of flowering or something. Unfortunately, it went in the direction of flamboyant elitism, which is why and the reaction to that, which is why we are here.
You could have been a Mrinal Sen, tapping into rural angst.
I think I'm happy to say that I could have been a Dibakar Banerjee. So I'm very happy being myself.
But no filmmaker is doing that at all. No, where are the Shyam Benegals? Where are the Mrinal Sens who are touching on an India? It seems that it's now middle class India, which is the mirror for filmmakers like you, like a Zoya Akhtar. Hindi medium kind of pictures are the ones that are doing successfully. Can you make a film, you believe, today, outside that little middle class world that we are in?
I think you're not looking at my filmography. See, I made Khosla Ka Ghosla when nobody thought a film like that could make. I've never spoken like this, but I mean, it's a good thing that you're saying this. I mean, I made Khosla Ka Ghosla when a film like that couldn't have been made. I made Lucky when everybody was expecting me to make Khosla Part 2. I made LSD when I knew that I would be facing huge censorship problems, which I faced, by the way. And I made Shanghai, and after that, I had cases against me because I wrote a song which had Bharat Mata Ki Jai and which said dengue malaria in the same line. So I think I've paid my dues, Rajdeep.
What was that last line you were telling me earlier in LSD, which you wanted to put in the film, which the censors put out?
See, the first story, if people have seen LSD, the first story had an incident at the end of it where the protagonists are beheaded. That's because a boy of a lower caste tries to marry a girl of an upper caste. And there's a dialogue as the killer is leading him to the beheading spot. He's saying, "Choti jaat ke kutte, tere ko ghar mein kya ghusne diya? Tu apni jagah bhool gaya." And I think that is the core message of a person who believes in the caste system violently.
So that line was cut out.
That line got cut, and the reason was that agar iske liye riots ho jaye ya busse jal jaye to kya aap uske responsibility lenge? Yeah, I was inexperienced. I wanted my film. My producer was standing behind. It was anyway a very experimental film. We didn't know that it would be the hit it was. We were quaking in our boots. So okay, cut dete hain. Chalo, theek hai. We'll put it in the DVD version or whatever. Fine. I mean, I caved in. This is how you cave in. Because if I hadn't caved in, then we wouldn't have caught our release date. So these are the necessary negotiations that you do with the sense. Now, the thing is, the sense, it does not depend on the regime. If we are really discussing about where are the Mrinal Sens and where are the Satyajit Rays and where are the Shyam Benegals or whatever, whatever, I can understand that. They were great filmmakers and we can't match up to them. That's what I should say. But there's another thing that can be said, that if you're really worried about the filmmakers having the kind of say and making that film like The Post, which Hollywood made, then let's all of us get together, let all the media houses with its nice clout with the government, with all the corporate houses with its nice clout with the government, get together and say, let us completely transform the film censorship laws. Let us not have a law which is... But let us not have an act which is from 1951. And when you look at that act, you see that the state has reserved arbitrary rights to control and to nuance and to change the voice of any film.
Shouldn't we just get rid of the censor board? Why do we need a film censorship? Why do we need certification from a... They just need to certify it. Why do they need to censor it? Should we get rid of it?
I've always said it. In fact, there is a draft plan that already exists, which says that there'll be ratings and not censorship. This is not new. This debate has been going on. Mr. Benegal has been working at it. Some other sort of, you know, senior people or minds have been working. This is not news.
So you think once that happens, maybe this prison of self-censorship
will be the first step,
get rid of the censor board altogether.
It'll be a first step. The second step will have to be that the governments, state governments, where those films are being screened, they will have to take onus. They cannot say that, listen, if your film comes and then mobs come on the roads and burn things, what do? We are stopping your film to preserve public peace. You cannot hunt with the foxes and run with the hare all the time. You cannot say that we are here to protect you as a citizen and at the same time say, listen, you are free to do it, but tomorrow if there'll be riots, what will I do? Are you the government? Yeah? You're the state. You are the one who's supposed to make sure that when someone's film, which is a film of dissent, which a democracy has to welcome and cherish, the government has to ensure that that film has to be screened and no one on the streets, no mob, no bully pulpit can actually stop that screening. But that doesn't happen.
So if you did a film on communal violence in Bengal, right?
Yeah.
With a strong woman leader on one side as one of the protagonists.
Yeah.
And a bearded man on the other as the other protagonist.
Yeah.
Right? You might well find a situation where, much like Padmavat found in Rajasthan, here the Bengal government decides, Dibakar Banerjee, that's it. We can't do anything if there are riots on the street. We won't allow your film to be shown in Bengal.
Bas, I'll have to cut the scenes. And then you'll call me in the next conclave and say, where's your spirit gone, Dibakar?
I'm trying to push you to do more edgy cinema, particularly in Bengal. Look at what's happened in Marathi cinema. My state, Sairat. So successful inter-caste marriage. The film is the biggest hit that Marathi cinema has seen. The same film went into Hindi cinema, didn't quite work. I'm just wondering, would you come now to Kolkata and do the kind of new age cinema that Bengali cinema needs a lift? No, Marathi cinema has gone ahead of you guys.
Bengali cinema does not need any help from me. Bengali cinema is absolutely safe without me and absolutely sort of, you know, happy without me. Now, this is a filmmaker. Now the filmmaker in me comes in. I will just make what I want to make and I will keep pushing what I have to push. There are real legal constraints to what I can say and what I cannot say. And I don't agree with those legal constraints. But I alone cannot change those legal constraints, nor any other filmmaker. So that's the first step that we have to cross. Then we can have this debate that where is your spirit and how can you do this? Then the second thing is that we do have the power of the mob today running many things in India. And this discourse can be seen in the form of identity politics, a much bigger debate. A filmmaker like me probably wouldn't be the right person to talk about it because I'm not supposed to know about social and political sort of, you know, subjects. But these are identity politic issues which have been carefully channelized into power. And this is what I said right in the beginning, that if the people who watch films are into power, are seduced by power, or are worshipping power, then that would be anti-democratic. Because that is the power that stops a Love, Sex or Dhoka from getting released. Fortunately, it did, or any other film. A film festival screening a Pakistani film is not allowed to screen that film. And the film festival has to backtrack. It's just a festival. It's not even a public screening. And it has to backtrack because it knows that the mob, the power of the mob, the power of the street politician will wreak havoc with this 15-day program where it has called filmmakers from all over the world. Now, what does the film festival do at that point? Take up its responsibilities as a guest, as a host, as a film festival, and just, you know, put that film down as a sacrificial lamb. Suppose you or Living Media had gotten a call, not that I'm not that important, fortunately, so that's great, had gotten a call, yaar, isko aap mat bulao. Kyun sir? Aap mat bulao. Aap usko bula lo. Would you have called me? Maybe not. And this happened. We are here because at many, many points when we should have said something, we said nothing. So this will happen.
So why don't you, for example, say in my next film, I'm going to get a Pakistani actress to act in it. I'm going to challenge these people. Let them do what they want. I am a filmmaker. The constitution of this country doesn't prevent a Pakistani woman from acting in my next film.
I'll do that. First of all, the question comes up whether I think that why shouldn't I cast an Indian actress who's right next door and who's as talented and who can do the role as much justice, and why should I go to the trouble of, you know, getting Pakistani actress for my film? That's another point altogether. But let us say there is nobody in India who can do that role and I have to go and sort of, you know, call up Islamabad and get visa and get into hundreds of bureaucratic issues and get that actor into India, and that actor is denied the visa and I'm sitting with crores running down on my set. I'll call you. Or any of you, you know, who are rooting for me or not rooting for me. Because that'll happen. That'll happen because there is no legal recourse against somebody stopping something by the arbitrary power of bullying. And, I mean, this will happen. I mean, I'll wait there, then the producer will call, yaar, wo ho gaya. Why don't you take the Indian actress who was our second choice? Because we waited for 15 days. We've lost 52 lakhs. It's not going to happen. Do you want your film to finish? Why don't we fold up this thing? Why don't you come back when you have another script? So I'll say, okay, take that actress. Because I have to make my film.
Tell me, Dibakar, you know, the Hindi film industry back in the headlines now for Nana Patekar and Tanushree Dutta. You yourself, Payal Rohtgi, once went to the media and said that she was denied a role because, Dibakar, I didn't accept the advances, to use the word, of Dibakar Banerjee. How do you see all this playing out? Is there a, you know, this whole Me Too campaign? How do you view it?
I'll hold my silence on what happened to me. But on an overall level, what's happening in the Me Too movement, I think it's okay.
It's okay.
I think it's good. Because what happens is when power shifts, no? Unfortunately, this is the way power shifts.
Is power shifting in the film industry to women?
Everywhere. Little bit. I would say it's devolution, devolvement. Little bit. Everywhere. And I think this, now the thing is, this is an example of the Me Too movement. Now, how many of us know who started the Me Too movement? One lady in the US in 2009. And the even I've forgotten her name. I used to know.
No, Harvey Weinstein was the...
No. The lady who started the Me Too movement started it as early as 2009. 2006, what was the lady's name? Yeah, so it started then. And because I think what had happened was, and we were discussing this during a scripting session and in the morning, was that I have a feeling that power, and I'm going on saying this, power is arbitrary. The main thing about power and unchecked power is arbitrary. Nahin, ye din nahin hai, ye raat hai. Haan, sir, raat hai. That's power. So what happens is that when that power shifts, power never shifts peacefully. Power shifts with a lot of mess and a lot of wheat and chaff going down together. But I know that every lone man in every situation today with another lone woman in the room is a little more conscious and cautious. That's great. That's good to start with. That's good to start with. And let's see where it goes from here. There will be there'll be battles of attrition. There'll be justified and not so justified cases. But I think on an overall thing, we should take it as the equivalent of the bus movement in the 1960s in,
Okay, South it was America. Started by Tarana Burke. I've Googled, I've got it right. So I 2006 indeed was the year when it started. Okay, let's end on a nice Bengali note. The Karolbagh kid, what is it about Kolkata and Bengalis that you find the most attractive? And what is it that really puts you off about Kolkata and Bengalis?
I'm a Bengali, so and I enjoy being a Bengali, but I'm lucky that I'm a Bengali who grew up in Delhi. So I enjoy being a Bengali, I enjoy being a Punjabi, I enjoy being a Jat. So I'm like kind of, triple times over. So I'm
Did you go for Pujo at Chitranjan Park ever?
No, because my own Pada Pujo is so big and so important that I can't even think of leaving that. And that's been happening for the last 30 years because it's my own Pada Pujo of which I have been the president of the Pujo committee myself.
You're the president of the Karolbagh Durga Puja committee?
No. It's where I
live. On Lal Bagh now?
No. It's in Delhi. It's a lovely place called Maya Enclave. And I was one fateful year, the president of the Durga Puja committee. I'm an atheist. I don't believe in any kind of deity or religion. So Durga Puja doesn't mean much to me, except the social sort of gathering around it. So I like it.
What's the best thing about Pujo?
I like the Anandamela because on Panchami, there's very, very nice food to eat. And what happens in Delhi is that it's different from the puja in Calcutta, is that it's a truly a Barwari Pada Pujo. It's a Mohalle ka Pujo. So this Mashi and that auntie and that Bhabi make their favorite snacks. So I used to like that. Then as kids, what used to happen in Delhi was that Pujo meant that we all had to put up plays, skits, dance dramas, various kind of cultural programs. So that kind of prepared me in many, many ways. For what I'm doing now. So that's great training. That's great training.
Butter chicken or kosha mangsho?
Oh, kosha mangsho any day.
Really?
Kosha
sure?
Mangsho. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It's nothing to... I mean, if you had asked palak paneer or palung shak bhaja, I may say palak paneer. But between butter chicken and kosha mangsho, any day kosha mangsho.
Between a sardar as a neighbor and a bong as a neighbor?
Sardar.
Okay. We'll end on that note. That's why you managed to capture that very Delhi middle class rather well in Khosla Ka Ghosla. And in many of your films, you managed to, in a sense, bring that new Indian emerging middle class to wider audiences. Dibakar Banerjee, continue with your filmmaking. Stay angry. It's the only way forward. And don't stay silent. Ladies and gentlemen, Dibakar Banerjee.